Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, girls and boys. I am here tonight to tell you of events which you may find hard to believe, but true they are. This story is best told after dark. In fact, better told in the dark. It is a story which will be embellished in your imaginations. So I invite you to listen with your eyes closed and with your ears open. Our story begins with a letter sent by one Jonathan Harker, lawyer's clerk, to his fiancée, Mina Murray.
Dearest Mina, as you know, I have to take my leave of you and England on a matter of urgent business. They say that absence makes the heart grow fonder, but nothing could increase me love for you. I will think of you every moment of every day, and hope that you too will think fondly of me. I intend to be away visiting Count Dracula in Transylvania for about 3 weeks, and will lovingly look forward to my return to you.
Mina replied,
Dearest Jonathan, may my love speed you on your journey and the Lord keep you safe. You will be constantly in my thoughts. I will spend the time you are away with my best friend Sharon. She will be no substitute for being with you, beloved. But despite being from a different social class, she is a good and constant companion. Lovingly yours, Mina. Kiss, kiss, kiss.
Jonathan Harker set off for Transylvania. And nothing was heard of him for quite some time. It was his journal, which only came to light after the events which will unfold, that tells of what happened to him.
In the spring of 1887, I was sent by my firm to meet with a client, one Count Dracula, who lives, if that's the right word, on the border of Transylvania, in the midst of the Carpathian Mountains, one of the wildest and least known parts of Europe. After much travelling, I came to the town of Bistritz. It was on the dark side of twilight when I presented myself at the Golden Krone Hotel, as directed by the Count. And much to my surprise, I was given a letter by the concierge.
This is for you, sir.
It was a letter from Count Dracula.
My friend, welcome to the Carpathians. I eagerly anticipate our conversation concerning my purchase of a property in London. Sleep well tonight. At 3 a.m. the coach will leave for Bukovina. There is a place on it to reserve for you. At the Borgo Pass, my carriage will await you and will bring you to me. Your friend, Dracula.
Then the concierge spoke.
Oh, sir, do you know what day it is?
I believe it to be the 4th of May, my good woman.
Yes, I know that, sir, I know that, but do you know what day it is? It is the eve of St. George's Day. Do you know that tonight, when the clock strikes midnight, all the evil things in the world will have full sway? Do you know where you are going and what you are going to do?
Dear woman, my duty is imperative and I must go.
Well, may the Lord be with you, sir, and take this with you for your mother's sake, sir.
It was a crucifix. I could not refuse it, but it set my mind at unease. In the early morning, as I boarded the coach, a crowd gathered at the door of the inn. As we departed, they all looked silently at me and made the sign of the cross and pointed 2 fingers at me. It was most unsettling. We drove for the rest of the day. When it grew dark, there seemed to be some growing anxiety amongst my fellow passengers, They kept speaking to the driver.
Faster, man, faster!
The driver lashed his horses unmercifully with his long whip, and with wild cries of encouragement, urged them on to further exertions. The excitement of the passengers grew greater. The coach rocked on its great leather springs and swayed like a boat tossed on a stormy sea. We all had to hold on tight. And as dusk fell, the mountains seemed to come nearer to us on each side and to frown down upon us. We were entering on the Borgo Pass. As we flew along, the driver leaned forward. And on each side, the passengers, craning over the edge of the coach, peered eagerly into the darkness. It was evident that something very exciting was either happening or expected. There were dark, rolling clouds overhead. And in the air, the heavy, oppressive sense of thunder. I looked out for the conveyance which was to meet us, to take me to the Count. Each moment I expected to see the glare of lamps through the blackness. But all was dark. There was on it no sign of a vehicle. The passengers drew back with a sigh of gladness. The driver, underestimating my understanding of his language, spoke to the other passengers.
We're an hour early, but don't tell the Englishman.
Then he turned to me.
There is no coach here to meet you, sir. Seems you're not expected after all. We'll have to go on to Bukovina.
Whilst he was speaking, the horses began to neigh and snort and plunge wildly, so that the driver had to hold them up. Then, amongst a chorus of screams from the peasants and a universal crossing of themselves, another coach, black, with four horses, drove up behind us, overtook us, and then drew up beside our coach. I could see from the flash of our lamps as the rays fell on them that the horses were coal black and splendid animals. They were driven by a tall man with a long brown beard and a great black hat, which seemed to hide his face from us. I could only see the gleam of a pair of very bright eyes, which seemed to turn red in the lamplight as he turned to us.
You are early tonight, my friend.
The Englishman? It was in a hurry, sir.
That is why I suppose you wished him to go to Bukovina, eh? You cannot deceive me, my friend. I know too much, and my horses are swift.
They say the dead travels fast.
The coachman evidently heard those words, for he looked up with a gleaming smile. The passenger turned his face away, at the same time putting out his two fingers and crossing himself.
Give me the Englishman's luggage.
And with exceeding alacrity, my bags were handed out and put in the black coach.
There you are. Take them quick.
Then I descended and climbed into the waiting coach. As my travelling companions gladly swept on their way to Bukovina and sank into the darkness, I felt a strange chill and a lonely feeling come over me. But a cloak was thrown over my shoulders and a rug across my knees.
The night is chill, mynheer, and my master, the Count, bade me take all care of you.
The journey was long and dark, and always we were ascending. The night was rent asunder with strange cries and callings coming from I know not where, till at last we came to the courtyard of a vast ruined castle, from whose tall black windows came no ray of light, and whose broken battlements showed a jagged line against the sky. Dismounting, I heard a heavy step approaching behind the great door and saw through the chinks the gleam of a coming light, then the sound of rattling chains and the clanking of massive bolts drawn back. A key was turned with the loud grating noise of long disuse, and the great door swung back. Within stood a tall, old man, clean-shaven save for a long white moustache, and clad in black from head to foot, without a single speck of colour about him anywhere. His mouth, so far as I could see it under the heavy moustache, was fixed and rather cruel-looking, with peculiarly sharp white teeth. The old man motioned me in with his right hand, with a courtly gesture.
Welcome to my house, Mr. Harker.
Count Dracula, I presume?
I am indeed Dracula, and I bid you welcome, Mr. Harker. Come in. The night air is chill. Do you hear them, Mr. Harker?
The wolves?
The children of the night. What music they make. But enough!
He suddenly lifted his hand, and the distant baying fell silent. I was amazed.
You must be tired, Mr. Harker. Your bed awaits, and tomorrow you should sleep as late as you can. I have to be away until the evening, but make yourself at home. You may go anywhere you like in the house, in the castle, except where the doors are locked. There is reason that things are as they are, and should you see it with my eyes and know with my knowledge, you would perhaps better understand. We are in Transylvania, and Transylvania is not England. Our ways are not your ways, Mr. Harker. Tomorrow evening, we shall speak of the purchase of my property in London. Do you know the house, perchance?
Indeed I do, sir. It is in the same street as a house belonging to Miss Sharon Westenra, a very close friend of my fiancée, Mina.
And which house would that be exactly, Mr. Harker?
Number 14, sir. The one with large windows on the first floor facing the street. Sharon's bedroom, I believe.
I see. Well, I am so looking forward to going to London. But for now, good night, Mr. Harker. Sleep well and dream sweetly.
I could not sleep and was afraid to dream that night, and so got up before it was light and prepared for the day ahead. I hung my shaving mirror by the window and was just beginning to shave when suddenly I felt a hand on my shoulder.
Good morrow, Mr. Harker.
I was startled, for it amazed me that I had not seen him, since the reflection in the curved glass covered the whole room behind me. In being startled, I had cut myself slightly, but did not notice it at the time. I turned to the glass again to see how I had been mistaken. This time there could be no error, for the man was close to me, and I could see him over my shoulder, but there was no reflection of him in the mirror. The whole room behind me was displayed, but there was no sign of a man in it, except myself. I then noticed that my shaving cut had bled down my chin, so I laid down the razor, turning as I did so, half round to look for some sticking plaster. When the Count saw my face, his eyes blazed with a demoniac fury, and he suddenly made a grab at my throat. I drew away, and his hand touched the string of beads which held the crucifix I had been given by the concierge at the inn. It brought him about in an instant. A change in him, for the fury passed so quickly, I could hardly believe that it was ever there.
Take care, Mr. Harker. Take care never to cut yourself. It is more dangerous than you think in this country. And this looking glass is the wretched thing responsible. It is a foul bauble of man's vanity. Away with it!
And that was the last I saw of my shaving mirror. I went into the dining room, where an early breakfast had been prepared, but I could not see the Count anywhere. So I breakfasted alone. It occurred to me that as yet I had not seen the Count eat or drink. After breakfast, I made an exploration of the castle. I went out on the stairs and found a window looking towards the south. The view was magnificent. The castle was on the very edge of a terrific precipice. A stone falling from the window would have fallen 1,000 feet without touching anything. I explored further, and all I encountered were doors, doors, doors everywhere, and all locked and bolted. In no place save from the windows and the castle walls was there an available exit. The castle was a veritable prison, and I was the prisoner. Later that evening, the Count, having returned from wherever he had gone, came to my room.
I trust you will forgive me, Mr. Harker, but I have much work to do in private this evening. Our conversation must wait a while. You will, I hope, find all the things as you wish until then.
At the door, he turned.
But let me advise you. My young friend, should sleep overcome you, or be like to do, then haste to your own chamber, and your rest will then be safe. Good night.
When he left me, I quickly went to the south staircase from where the window affords that most lovely view. I leaned out. My eye was caught by something moving a floor below me, and where, I imagined, that the windows of the Count's own room would look out. What I saw was the Count's head coming out from the window. Then I saw the whole man slowly emerge from the window and begin to crawl down the castle wall over the dreadful abyss, face down, with his cloak spreading out around him like great wings. I saw his fingers and toes grasp the corners of the stones, and by thus using every projection, move downwards with considerable speed, just as a lizard moves down a wall. Oh, I then felt the morbid dread of this place overpowering me. I was in fear, in awful fear, and there was no escape for me. I was encompassed about with terrors that I dare not think of. That night, I could not sleep, not a wink, and in the early hours, I realized that I was not alone. The room was the same, unchanged, but opposite me were 3 young women, ladies by their dress, what little there was of it. I thought at the time that I must be dreaming when I saw them, as they threw no shadow on the floor. Then they came closer toward me.
Oh, look at this one. He looks like a good night out.
He's all mine. I saw him first.
They came close to me, and in the dim light of the room, I could clearly see their female form through the diaphanous garments they lightly wore. They looked at me for some time and then whispered together.
All right, you go first and we'll follow. He's so young and strong.
There'll be enough for all of us.
The women threw off the last vestiges of their garments and stood before me in complete nakedness. One was tall and slim, with full breasts. And as she approached me, I could also see that she had long, brilliant white teeth that shone like pearls against the ruby of her voluptuous, moist lips in the moonlight. I lay quiet, looking out from under my eyelashes in an agony of delightful anticipation. The girl advanced and bent over me till I could feel her breast on me arm. She had a deliberate voluptuousness which was both thrilling and repulsive as she arched her neck and licked her lips like an animal. I could see moisture shining on her scarlet lips and on the red tongue as it licked the white, sharp teeth. Her body felt firm yet soft as she climbed onto my bed and sat astride me. I could feel the warmth of her soft, naked form through the bedsheets, and I gave up all thoughts of resistance as her body pressed against mine, and her lips came ever closer in what I knew could be a fatal embrace. But then her head passed below the range of my mouth and chin and seemed to fasten on my neck. I could feel the shivering touch of her lips on the skin of my throat and two sharp teeth just touching and pausing there. I closed my eyes in languorous ecstasy and waited with beating heart.
Get off him! Get off him, you curse, you woman! Get off him!
It was the Count. I saw his hands grasp the woman's slender shoulders and with a giant strength pull her away from me. She fell back on my legs before falling to the floor in a naked heap.
How dare you touch him, any of you? How dare you cast eyes on him when I had forbidden it? Back, back, I tell you all. This man belongs to me. Stay away from him, or you'll have to deal with me.
Deal with you? You haven't dealt with any of us for many a full moon. You only know where to put your teeth these days.
Then the Count turned to them, after looking at my face attentively.
When I am done with this fine young man, you can enjoy him at your will. But now, go! Go! There is work to be done.
Go, well... Nothing again tonight, girls.
And they disappeared. But there was no door near them, and they could not have passed me without me noticing. They simply seemed to fade into the rays of the moonlight and pass out through the window. And for a moment I could see outside three shadowy, naked forms before they entirely faded away. The horror of it all overcame me, and I sank down into unconsciousness.
Phew. Thank goodness for that.
In the morning, I was awakened by the Count.
Tomorrow, my friend, we must part. You to return to your beautiful England. I to some work which must be done.
But, sir, unwilling as I am to stay here a moment longer than necessary, we have yet to discuss your house in London.
I think we have discussed enough already, Mr. Harker. Tomorrow morning my coach will come for you and will bear you to the Borgo Pass to meet the coach from Bukovina to B Streets.
I want to leave right away. Why can't I leave now?
Because, dear sir, my coachman and horses are away on a mission.
But I would walk with pleasure. I want to get away at once.
And your baggage?
Well, I care not about it. I can send for it some other time.
Very well. Come with me, my dear young friend. Not an hour shall you stay in my house against your will, though sad am I at your going and that you suddenly so desire it. Come, come.
With a stately gravity, he, with a lamp, proceeded me down the stairs and along the hall. Suddenly he stopped.
Hark!
Close at hand came the howling of many wolves. It was almost as if this sound sprang up at the rising of his hand, just as the music of a great orchestra seems to leap under the baton of the conductor. After a pause of a moment, he proceeded in his stately way to the door, drew back the ponderous bolts, unhooked the heavy chains, and began to draw it open.
As the door began to open, the howling of the wolves without grew louder and angrier. Their red jaws, with champing teeth, came in through the opening door. I knew better than to struggle against the Count. It was useless. With such allies as these creatures at his command, I could do nothing. But still, the door continued slowly to open, and only the Count's body stood in the gap. Suddenly it struck me that this might be the moment and means of my doom. I was to be given to the wolves at my own instigation. Shut the door! I shall wait till tomorrow! With one sweep of his powerful arm, the Count threw the door shut. And the great bolts clanged and echoed through the hall as they shot back into their places. In silence, we returned to the library. And after a minute or two, I went to my own room. The last I saw of Count Dracula was his kissing his hand to me, with a red light of triumph in his eyes, and with a smile that Judas in hell might be proud of. These may be the last words I ever write in this diary. When I woke, I threw myself on my knees, for I determined that if death came, he should find me ready. Then came the welcome cockcrow, and I felt that I was safe. I determined then and there to gain entry to the Count's room. I rushed to the east window and limbered myself down the wall and climbed into the Count's room through a window. The room was empty, but that was as I expected. I went through a door in the corner and down a winding stair, along a dark passage, and arrived in an old chapel from which came a deathly, sickly odour, the smell of fetid earth newly turned and placed in a great wooden box on which lay the Count, looking as if his youth had been half restored. The white hair and moustache were changed to dark iron grey. The cheeks were fuller, and the white teeth seemed ruby red underneath. The mouth was redder than ever, and on the lips were gouts of fresh blood, which trickled from the corners of the mouth and ran down over the chin and neck. Even the deep, burning eyes seemed set amongst swollen flesh, for the lids and pouches underneath were bloated. It seemed as if the whole awful creature were simply gorged with blood. He lay like a filthy leech, exhausted with his repletion. I thought this to be my moment. I took a nearby shovel and determined to put an end to this evil creature. But I know not if the shovel went right through his head or if his head went right through the shovel. Either way, it made no impression. I cannot recall what I did next, nor how I returned to my room, but the next morning I awoke to the sound of horses and cartwheels below in the courtyard. Men were loading heavy boxes, all filled with dug earth, like the one I saw the Count at repose in the day before. I watched as a workman went to a box from which the toes of a pair of boots were just visible. He pushed the boots down into the soil, then hammered nails into what I can only describe as a coffin, took a brush and painted a long red stripe down the centre of the box, and then four men heaved it onto the waiting cart. As the cart, with its four horses, moved out of the castle yard, I realized that I was now all alone, locked inside Count Dracula's castle. I resolved to make my escape once again, using the perilous nooks and protuberances down the side of the building used by the Count for his nocturnal excursions.
And at that point, Jonathan Harker's journal ends. We shall have to wait to learn of his fate, but During the time of these events, Jonathan Harker's fiancée, Mina, had been visiting her friend Sharon.
Oh, Shazza, I am driven to distraction by the lack of news about dear Jonathan. It's been over 2 weeks since he left. I hoped he would have sent a letter telling of his safe arrival.
Oh, don't worry, Means. He'll be all right, I'm sure.
Yes, well, I hope you're right. I know I shouldn't be so selfish worrying away like this when you have such a happy time in prospect. I can see you now, decked with flowers in your hair and looking so radiant as you glide like a swan up the aisle of Hampstead Church.
Oh, Sharp! You do think I've made the right choice, though, don't you, Means?
Indeed you have, Shaz. Mr. Holmwood is so rich.
Yeah, he's well stacked, all right. But he's not very bright, is he? But you can't have everything, can you? Oh, I suppose you're right, Minns. It can't really go wrong, can it?
You are the luckiest girl in London, Shaz. As you would say, I'm well gel.
Oh, behave, girl.
Now, tell me all the goss. What's been happening?
Oh, not much, really. Just the usual stuff you read in Good Day, Sir magazine. But actually, you know, there was something the other night.
Oh, do tell.
Well, you know that empty house across the road? The one your Jonathan has gone to see Count What's-His-Name in the Cairngorms about?
The Carpathians.
Whatever. Well, Tuesday evening, just as it was getting dark, I saw a big awesome cart draw up and four geezers get out and carry a great big heavy box with a long red stripe on it down the steps of the basement. It was so bleeding heavy they could hardly manage to do it without dropping it. They put it inside, locked the door and left. I thought, oh my God! Bit weird, don't you think, Minns?
Most strange. No sign yet of the new owner, I suppose.
Nah, at the end of the day, apart from the heavy box, the house seems empty and closed.
Well, that will all change soon, I expect.
And how right she was. A few days later, Mina received a note sent by Sharon's mother, asking her to come to their house immediately.
Oh, Miss Mina, thank you for coming. I'm a bit concerned for my Sharon. I ain't seen her like this since we moved here from Brentwood after my late Harry won the lottery. Last night, I found her sleepwalking around the house. Fancy that! And then this morning, when I went to wake her up with a nice cup of tea, I noticed two little red marks on her neck that definitely weren't there yesterday.
This is slightly alarming, Mrs. Westenra. I think we should inform Sharon's fiancé, Mr. Holmwood, right away. He'll know what to do. He's
so rich. But a bit thick, if you ask me. But you're right. I'll send him a note. Come in, have a cup of tea. Let's hope he can come quickly.
Mrs. Westenra sent a note to Holmwood, and he arrived in no time at all. And spent a few moments with Sharon before returning to Mina and Mrs. Westenra.
Well, Mrs. Westenra, this is most concerning. I have a theory.
A theory, Mr. Holmwood? That's most unexpected of you.
But I will not alarm you with it until I have consulted my friend Dr. Van Helsing at the University of Amsterdam, who knows a thing or two about strange happenings.
Right.
I shall contact him by electronic telegraph right away.
Electronic telegraph, sir?
Yes, it's a wonderful invention. In its infancy now, mind you. But someday, who knows, we might be able to talk to people who are not in the same places as oneself.
No.
Send text messages, do Facebook, and perhaps Google.
Perhaps what, sir? Whatever are you talking about?
I have absolutely no idea, madam. No idea at all.
Sounds fun, though.
Holmwood to Van Helsing. Come to London immediately. Most disquieting set of symptoms observed.
Mina departed for Bath to visit her maiden aunt for a few days, and Van Helsing duly arrived in London.
My dear Van Helsing! Good to see you. Thanks for coming.
Yep.
And he told Van Helsing the story of Sharon's condition.
And if I was shocked when I saw her yesterday, I was horrified when I saw her today. She was ghastly, white as a sheet. The red seemed to have gone from her lips and gums. The bones of her face stood out prominently. Her breathing was painful to see and hear. She did not seem to have strength to speak.
Step outside, Holmwood. This is most worrying. There is no time to be lost. She would die for sheer want of blood to keep the heart at action as it should be. There must be a transfusion of blood at once. Now, is it to be you or me?
Professor, I am younger, stronger, and very suggestible. It must be me. If only you knew how gladly I would die for Sharon Westonwer, you would understand.
Then, get ready at once. I'll get my bag. In the not so far off, she will be happy that you did all possible for the woman you love. Now, roll up your sleeves.
The transfusion took place, and with renewed blood, Sharon's condition improved.
So, Homewood, it seems together we have saved Sharon from the jaws of death.
I say, Van Helsing, what do you make of those marks on her neck?
Well, I initially thought that such a wound, being on the external jugular, could have been the reason for the loss of blood that caused her near-fatal pallor. But I abandoned that notion. The whole bed would have been drenched to a scarlet with the blood which the girl must have lost to leave such a pallor as she had before the transfusion. But I have another thought of which I will not speak at present. I will have a schmuck and consider my idea closely. Meet me back here this evening.
The evening came, and with it, Van Helsing carrying a huge bunch of vegetation.
It looks like you had a good smoke, Professor.
It's what we Dutch people do, Homewood, and we have cafes to do it in. Now, Homewood, you shall help me deck Miss Sharon's room with garlic.
It must have been rather a strong smoke. With garlic, you say? Can't stand the stuff myself, but I'm sure you know what you're doing.
The two men first fastened up the windows and latched them securely. Next, taking a handful of the flowers, they rubbed them all over the sashes, as though to ensure that every whiff of air that might get in would be laden with the garlic smell. Then they rubbed all over the jamb of the door, above, below, and at each side, and round the fireplace in the same way.
Well, Professor, I know you always have a reason for what you do, but this certainly puzzles me. If I didn't know better, I would say that you were working some spell to keep out an evil spirit.
Perhaps I am, Homewood. Perhaps I am. Ah, here comes your intended, Homewood.
Ah, Sharon, my dearest, looking radiant and ready for bed, I see.
I am now 100% again, and I trust I will sleep like a log. Poor, what's that horrible smell?
It is a balm, a Dutch balm.
There was a lot of them in Essex.
A balm of garlic to aid your sleep and to ensure a restful night. Now, I want you to wear this garland of garlic about your neck. Now, take care you do not disturb it. And even if the night is warm, do not open the window or the door, huh?
All right, if you say so, I promise. And thank you both 1,000 times for all your kindness to me. Mwah, mwah.
After the two men departed, Sharon wrote an entry in her journal.
Well, here I am tonight, hoping for a good keep. That Dr. Van Helsing is a funny one and no mistake. I wonder why he's so anxious about these flowers. He really put the willies up me, was so on about it. But he must know what he's talking about, because I'm feeling much better already. I'm not scared of being alone tonight, and I'm going to ignore any flapping noises outside the window. I never much liked garlic before, but not tonight it's, well, lovely. There is a peace in its pong. I feel sleep coming already.
Sharon Westonra initially fell into a full and deep sleep, but the events of which her journal speaks tell the true story of that fateful night.
It is the middle of the night, and I'm writing this and leaving it where it will be seen. I feel I am dying of weakness, and I have no strength to write,
but I'm going to write it if I die in the doing. I went to bed as usual, taking care that the flowers were placed as Dr. Van Helsing said, and soon fell asleep. I was awoken by a big flapping noise at the window. I got out of bed and looked out, but I couldn't see nothing, so I went back to bed again. Then there was this massive crash at the window, and a lot of broken glass was hurled all over the floor. The curtains blew back with the wind that rushed in, and in the broken planes there was a bat the size of a man, and I thought, I'm a god!
Sharon's handwriting here tails into a single line of ink. Early the next morning, Van Helsing and Homewood called to inquire of Sharon's condition. They met her mother on the doorstep.
She's very well, sir. Still fast asleep. I didn't have the heart to wake her.
It's very good, Mrs. Westenra. Now, do you mind if we take a look? Perhaps she's awake now?
Yeah, go right ahead, gentlemen. I'll wait here.
Quick, Homewood. There's not a moment to lose. Ah, it's just as I feared, Homewood. Now look, look what's left of the window. Ah, look at the poor girl's neck. There's another double puncture wound. Get Mrs. Westenra immediately.
Mrs. Westenra! Mrs. Westenra!
Why, sir, what's all this hullabaloo about?
Mrs. Westenra, did anyone go into Sharon's room after we left last night?
No one, sir. Well, only me. I went in to see if she was all right. She was sleeping soundly, so soundly that even I couldn't wake her. But the room was awfully stuffy. There were a lot of horrible, strong-smelling flowers everywhere. And she actually had a bunch of them round her neck. I reckoned that the smell would be too much for the dear child in her weak state. So I took them all away and opened the window a bit to let in a little fresh air.
I see. Thank you, Mrs. Westenra.
Is she all right, Dr. Van Helsing?
There's nothing to worry about for now. Now, leave her with us for a while, huh?
Oh, very well. I expect you know what you're doing. I'll be off now. Don't want to miss me bingo.
Homewood, I don't know how to tell you this, but Sharon...
What, Van Helsing?
She's
what?
She's dead. With the garlic removed, she was at the mercy of one who preys on the living for blood. Drained of blood, she had no strength to go on. But did you notice, Homewood? Death has given back part of her beauty. For her brows and her cheeks have recovered some of their flowing lines. Her lips have lost their deadly pallor. You know, it is as if the blood, no longer needed for the working of the heart, she had gone to make the harshness of death as little rude as might be.
Oh, my poor, dear girl. Can this really be the end for her and for us? We were to be married, Van Helsing, but there is peace for her, if not for me. I must be strong.
The following day, Sharon's body was interred in the crypt of the church in Hampstead. It was a small affair, just Van Helsing, Homewood, and Sharon's mother. It's at this point in the story we must need to recall the situation of Jonathan Harker. We left Jonathan perilously descending the walls of Castle Dracula. Having had no news from the Carpathian Mountains for months, Mina, as she told Sharon, had been driven to her wit's end. No news was certainly not good news. But on the day she arrived back from Bath, a letter from Jonathan arrived and Mina wanted to share the news with Sharon. Little did she know Sharon's fate.
Why, young Miss Mina, we haven't seen you for many a day.
Hello, Mrs. Westenra. No, I'm only just back from Bath. I've come to see Sharon. I trust she's well.
You better come in, Miss Mina. It's a long story. This is Dr. Van Helsing, and you know Mr. Ormwood?
Yes. Why, hello. Is everything all right?
Van Helsing and Homewood told Mina of the events of the past days.
Why, that's terrible. Awful. Poor Sharon. Just as her life looked all set for the future. Oh, my. Fate is such a cruel thing. Oh, Mr. Homewood, how awful for you.
When Mina recovered, she told them of the content of the letter she had received from Jonathan Harker. Jonathan, it seems, had fallen the final 20 meters of the castle precipice and received a near fatal blow to the head. A local peasant found him and carried him unconscious to the Golden Krona Hotel, from whence he had set out on his last part of his journey to Castle Dracula. The concierge took pity on him and nursed him slowly back to a semblance of good health.
There, there, Mr. Harker. You lie still and take this potion every 2 hours. It will make you feel better in next to no time. That's a nasty bump on your head. I did try to warn you, though. That Castle Dracula and its evil owner have brought misery to everyone who goes near it. And that's not all. Every young woman around here is scared to go out after dark. Why, 3 young women went missing last spring. They went for a walk near the castle and never returned. We all suspected the worst.
Why? Did they all eat undercooked sausages?
No, sir, they got too close to Castle Dracula.
Jonathan's letter went on to say that Castle Dracula was not so much the home of a kindly old Transylvanian gent who had recently bought a house in London. More, it was the lair of a rampant, insatiable, blood-sucking vampire.
And here's another strange thing. When I spoke to Sharon just before I went to see my aunt in Bath, she told me that the previous evening she awoke and saw 4 men carry a large, heavy box with a bright red stripe down the centre of it, down the basement steps of the house across the road, the very house that Jonathan had gone to Transylvania to discuss with the Count. In Jonathan's letter, he says he watched from a window at Castle Dracula as a workman sealed a large, heavy box, painted a bright red stripe down the centre of it, and with 3 other men hauled it onto a castle which departed from the castle. Don't you think that's a bit of a coincidence?
My God, Homewood, you know what this means?
Why don't you tell me, Van Helsing?
That poor girl that we interned in the crypt of the Hampstead Church. She was not dead. She was undead.
Whatever do you mean, undead?
As an undead is someone who is deceased yet behaves as if alive. They say that if a person is bitten by a vampire whilst in a state of unconsciousness, like while sleepwalking, they die but retain the appearance of a living person.
So you mean that Sharon was bitten by a vampire while sleepwalking and became undead so she could be ever available for the heinous needs of the vampire.
By George, you've got it.
Look, quick, over there. There they are again, just as Sharon described.
And Mina pointed to the house across the street where 4 men were heaving a large wooden box with a red stripe down the middle onto a waiting cart.
Now everything falls into place. We must go to the Hampstead Church without further delay.
To do what?
To save the poor child from eternal torment. Now come.
Wait, I'm coming too.
The 3 of them set off across London to the crypt of the Hampstead Church, wholly unaware that Jonathan Harker, now recovered, had arrived at Harwich earlier in the day and was making his way to London.
And where might you be again, young man, if I might be so bold as to ask?
I'm bound for London, and the girl I love, sir.
Been away long?
Longer than I dare think. Anything could have happened in my absence.
Indeed it could.
The coach duly brought Jonathan Harker to London, where his first stop was the house of his beloved Mina.
Why, Mr. Harker, we servant girls didn't know if we would ever see you again.
Yes, Emily, it's me, back from my adventures. Is Miss Mina at home?
Why, no, sir. She went to see Miss Sharon early this morning. She ain't come back yet.
Jonathan went to Sharon's house.
Why, Mr. Harker, we didn't know if we would ever see you again.
Yes, Miss Mastenra. It's me, back from my adventures. Is Mina here?
Well, she was, but now she ain't. Yeah, come in, Mr. Harker. It's a long story.
And Jonathan went inside and Mrs. Westenra told him the long story. And when she got to the part where Homewood, Van Helsing and Mina left for the crypt in Hampstead, Jonathan leapt up.
My good Mrs. Westenra, why didn't you tell me the end bit before the long bit? Oh dear, there's no time to lose. I must get to Hampstead.
And with that, he rushed out of the house in search of a hansom cab. But it was raining, and there wasn't a hansom cab to be seen.
Cab! Cab!
Once again, we will leave Jonathan's plight for a while and go immediately to Hampstead, where the fearless trio are about to arrive at the church gate.
Can you see anything, Van Helsing?
I can see some very deep cartwheel tracks in the mud. I suspect the Count has beaten us here.
Yes, the accursed rain caused all the hansom cabs in London to disappear. We were lucky to get on the number 24 bus. And what a queue.
Shush, Homewood. This is deadly serious. Now, follow me. What was that?
Looks like a bat to me. A very large bat. You don't think...
Let's not let our imagination run away, Homewood. There's work to be done. Now come, we must get into the crypt.
It's very dark.
There she is. There she is, over there.
Van Helsing walked over to Sharon's coffin. He bent over and forced back the leaden flange. There lay Sharon, seemingly just as she was the night before her funeral. She was, if possible, more radiantly beautiful than ever. Her lips were redder than before, and on the cheeks was a delicate bloom. But on her neck, fresh red marks.
You see, Homewood, her living blood, it still flows. Well, there's nothing for it. I must do what I have come to do, however harrowing it will surely be. Now, please, pass me those two pieces of wood, Homewood.
You're going to make a holy cross to ward off evil?
No, Homewood. I'm going to use one piece of wood to strike the other piece of wood, and to pierce poor Sharon's heart. Only then, that way, she will be set free from the evil vampire and join the righteous dead. Courage, courage, my child. Now cover your eyes. You too, Homewood. This will not be a pretty sight. There. There. That should be in far enough. They say that the moment of exorcism causes a momentary glow in the air around the body. Ah.
Yes, there it is. Oh, dear Sharon, now you are finally laid to rest. Sleep well, my dear, dear friend.
Ah! Is that big bad man again?
So, if you think that by killing Count Dracula's bride you have stopped his nocturnal activities, you are wrong, gentlemen. Very wrong. Why? It seems you have bought me a fine replacement. And who might you be, you beautiful young thing?
Don't tell him, Mina. Oh.
Mina, what a lovely name. You will do very well. Very well indeed.
You lay a finger on her, Dracula, and...
And I'll... what will you do, sir?
I'll call the police.
Sir, I am one of the undead and beyond the reach of your living world.
Quick, you two. Let's get out of here. Our work is done.
Yes, perhaps you should. That door there is the quick way out.
And the three of them ran for the door to which Dracula pointed, but which, as they quickly discovered, was not an exit, but the entrance to an adjacent room. Holmwood was first to go through and was quickly followed by Van Helsing. Such was their disregard for gallantry under stress, leaving poor Mina to be grabbed around the waist by Count Dracula as he slammed the door shut. And locked the two men inside.
Hey, you, let us out!
You are horrible! Horrible, Dracula!
So, now, my sweet young thing, we are alone. We should get better acquainted, don't you think?
No, no, don't touch me! Get off me!
Mina! Is that you? Are you inside?
Yes! Oh, yes! Is that you, Jonathan? Jonathan!
Mina!
So, Mr. Harker, we meet again.
You lay a finger on a Dracula, and you'll get what you deserve.
Is that a gun in your right hand, Mr. Harker?
It most certainly is, and in a moment it will be smoking.
As Jonathan leveled his pistol at the Count, Dracula made a lunge for Mina's neck, but before his teeth could touch her delicate skin... and the Count fell to the floor.
Mina! My dear, are you all right?
Yes, dearest, I think so. But had you not arrived when you did, I fear I would be another of his victims.
He will have no more victims, my dearest. He is dead now.
No, he's not. He needs a stake through the heart to be properly dead. Let us out, and I'll send him on his way.
Stand away from the door!
Jonathan shot the lock, and Holmwood and Van Helsing tumbled out.
Oh.
Van Helsing removed the stake from Sharon's body and began driving it into the Count.
There. It's over.
Oh, thank you, sir. That was a brave deed, but I don't think we have met.
Ah, let me introduce you. Jonathan, this is Mr. Van Helsing.
Oh, Dr.
From
Van
Amsterdam.
Helsing.
And Mr. Holmwood is, rather...
How do you do?
Yes.
Oh, Jonathan, it's so good to have you back.
My dearest Mina, all the time I was in Transylvania, being nursed back to health, it was the thought of you, the only thing that kept me going. And now I'm back, I have something to ask of you.
Yes, Jonathan.
Mina, my dearest...
Yes, yes.
Mina... Will you marry me?
Oh, Jonathan, yes, of course I will.
Oh!
And on that one happy note in a tale of much unhappiness, our story comes to an end. Jonathan and Mina were buried in the Hampstead church which contained the bodies of Sharon and the Count. And Van Helsing and Holmwood went off to Indonesia and were never heard of again. I thank you for listening to our story. Don't have nightmares. Sleep well.